Hey guys, hope you're all doing well. Now for today's video, I'm going to be joined by a very special guest from the Jurassic Park podcast. This man has actually worked with many different Jurassic-related websites and publications, including Outpost, Collect Jurassic, as well as Jurassic Collectibles. So go ahead, Tom. How are you doing, man?
Hey, man. Yeah, I'm good. It's really cool to finally be here. Yeah, thank you for having me on, and thank you for giving me such a great intro. I feel like you kind of hit everywhere that I tend to pop up there.
Yeah, well, I mean, you do a lot of work in, like, the Jurassic Park space. Like, you gotta bounce around to, like, every single individual website and podcast yeah. there is. So I was like, I might as well just throw everything out there. So yeah, Tom, he knows what he's talking about. He's been around the block. I'm sure you pretty much are already familiar with him before, if you haven't. Even though he's never been on the channel, we've met in real life. We saw Fallen yeah. Kingdom together. So Yeah,
it's good to be here, and I'm excited. I think now, obviously, while we're all at home, we've got a little bit more time to use for other stuff, so it's a really good time to think about Dominion and think about the franchise and just all of the things that we're looking forward to with it.
Oh yeah, totally. And I actually wanted to talk to you specifically about Dominion today. So I actually wanted to talk to you specifically about some of what Jeff Goldblum recently said in relation to a certain scene that the big three original cast members have filmed. So I'm going to quote him here just so that we get everything right. Jeff Goldblum recently said, "The first thing that we shot, it was a scene with me and Laura Dern and Sam Neill, and we were, I can't tell you much, but we were all day in a very tight enclosed space. You'll see, it's a mystery you'll solve when you see the movie. The three of us were in a tiny little space, and we were being menaced by, I can't even tell you, but a surprising faction of prehistoric creatures that you've never seen before. We saw some amazing things. We were acting in a life and death situation." And he also says, "We think it might be the last moments of our lives, and we're all bonding with each other in an emotional and somewhat hilarious way." Now, when he mentioned that they would be bonding with each other, one of the things that immediately sprang up in my head was the fact that Alan Grant and Ellie Sattler were together in the first Jurassic Park, and Ian Malcolm was kind of an antagonizing force that could have jeopardized that relationship, right? So Grant is not, I would imagine Grant is not too keen on Malcolm, and I have a feeling that if they are about to die, and there's like a dinosaur attack going over them, and I could see like Grant just being like, "Shut up, Malcolm."
I mean, it'd be quite funny if they called it back to Jurassic Park 3 and maybe Grant's just like, "Oh, well, at least one of us got a book deal," or something like that. I could see that being quite funny.
It'll be interesting to see how they take this whole situation, because realistically, we know Alan Grant and Ellie Sattler care about each other, right?
Yeah, definitely.
And this is another thing that I don't think everyone is aware of, but after Jurassic Park premiered, Laura Dern and Jeff Goldblum were actually in a legit real relationship in real life.
Oh, whoa. I didn't know that. Wow.
Oh, you didn't know that? Yeah.
No.
They were in a real relationship up until The Lost World came out. Laura Dern, I almost called her Ellie Sattler. Laura Dern was at the premiere of The Lost World, I believe. You can look up the images of it online. It's really cool. But there's also a comic book tie-in that I keep talking about a lot. But like, Ellie Sattler actually made out with Ian Malcolm in the old 1990s comic books. And it was kind of a strain on Grant's relationship because they didn't know where that was going. But it was a fleeting thing. And I wonder, these three characters, and this, I honestly believe this was kind of the issue with the first trilogy as far as characters go, is we never saw all three of them and we followed like the same story, like continue over. Now, it's cool that Malcolm was like the lead in Lost World, and it's cool that Grant came back in three, but I always felt that Laura Dern got kind of shafted, where she wasn't really used properly. So
no, I agree. I mean, she's literally just a cameo in Jurassic Park 3, and that's it.
They kind of used her like they used Hammond in Lost World, only not as important, so it made me feel bad. But do you think that Laura Dern's involvement in Jurassic World Dominion, I know Colin Trevorrow has talked about this a lot, about how he also feels the same way, that Laura Dern never got her own movie, do you think that they'll try to up that during scenes like this where they're all together, like sort of bonding while the dinosaurs are attacking? It's like, what do you think they're gonna do with her character specifically?
I just thinking about it now on the spot, I could see her being quite an interesting role model kind of character for Claire. So obviously in the past, Colin has said that this whole trilogy of films is meant to be Claire's story, and obviously there's a lot of debate about whether it is or not, but I could see her perhaps factoring into that as being somebody who Claire can look up to, because obviously Claire's done the DPG, she cares greatly about these animals, so maybe there's something that she can take away from Ellie there, and that's kind of where she would slot into the story. But I think more kind of sort of beyond that, when you think about people who kind of had the most intense experiences in Jurassic Park, yes, Malcolm got chased by the T-Rex and obviously got thrown into a toilet, but Ellie actually had arguably one of the most intense experiences in terms of going into the emergency bunker and trying to get the power back on. So I kind of feel like maybe that experience might have equipped her to be a little bit more emotionally resilient to deal with the situations that they're encountering. So in this particular scene, for example, where they're all being faced in these tight quarters, obviously it's something that Malcolm hasn't really encountered because he was basically unconscious for the latter half of Jurassic Park. But for Ellie and Alan, they've experienced that in the visitor center, and obviously Ellie in the bunker as well, so I could see her maybe being the character sort of making the hard choices and getting everyone out alive. I kind of feel like that would sort of be the best way to do it, because then you've kind of got an opportunity for her to contribute to Claire's character development, but also an opportunity to kind of build on some of the experiences she's had. And I'd also say you don't know what she's done in her life up until this point. Maybe her connections to Mark, again, hot topic, I'm gonna upset a lot of people here, but if she is still with Mark, if she's not, whatever, those connections could potentially factor into this story as well. Who knows what kind of contact she's gonna have and how that's gonna influence the way that these characters are dealing with dinosaurs in the real world. So I think there's a lot of potential for her.
Yeah, I do wonder a lot. You brought up the whole relationship that she had in Jurassic Park 3. I wonder if they will touch upon that in this movie, because that little boy that she had, Charlie, he'll be, what, like 21 years old, I believe?
Yeah.
So he's all grown up. She's not, like, babysitting anybody as far as we know. I mean, she could have another daughter or son that we're unaware of, but I wonder if they'll, like, blow by that, and if they do, will we get any sort of information on what Dr. Sattler has been doing since Jurassic Park 3? Obviously, it looks like Alan Grant is totally into the whole researching dinosaurs thing.
Yeah.
So if Sattler is right there with him, I do wonder, obviously she was a paleobotanist, not a paleontologist, but like you said earlier, she did face like a lot of pretty intense situations in Jurassic Park. And what's really cool about Laura Dern's role in Jurassic Park, I sincerely mean this, no one else in that movie is as realistically terrified, but also like terrified in a way that I have to do this and I have to get this job done, like Laura Dern is. Like when she screams shit, 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 like while they're like that, to me that is so real. You've got like Bob Peck is smiling and he's like, you know, Ian Malcolm's making one-liners, must go faster and blah blah, she is just screaming at the top,
she's just there like, why the hell am I here?
Yeah, well, and to further like go into that, when she goes to turn the power back on for Jurassic Park, she's screaming at the Velociraptor and she gets it done, right? But she gets out of the bunker and she shuts that gate and she just starts like, I don't think I've ever seen someone cry that realistically in like a monster situation like I have right there. But yeah, you are right. She has really put herself in like some pretty dangerous situations in the original movie, which is all the more reason why I think it does make sense that she would actually be something of a guiding figure for Claire Dearing. Now, I actually think she could also be one for Owen Grady.
Yeah, I could see that. I think I kind of like the idea of Owen having a parallel with Alan, purely because of obviously the common raptor association.
That will like, totally be in the movie. Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm sure that they'll try to incorporate some Ian Malcolm and Claire Deering time.
Yeah.
Because Malcolm's always been the hand waver to be like, no, 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 you shouldn't have done this. And Claire Deering, I mean, she did try to save all the dinosaurs in the mixed her up with Sarah Harding in The Lost World. How the hell? That's a whole other time. How is Sarah Ian Malcolm's girlfriend? Has anybody ever thought that?
Are you saying that Claire's going to be Ian Malcolm's girlfriend in
No. I didn't mean it like that. I meant she tried to save the dinosaurs in Fallen Kingdom. Ultimately, she made the decision not to push the button, so to speak.
Yeah.
But I can imagine Ian Malcolm totally getting on her case. Because she is, at the end of the day, responsible, at least partly, just like people have argued, like Nick Van Owen is responsible for the T-Rex being loose in San Diego because he took Roland's bullets and that led to the butterfly effect of him getting the tranquilizer darts. And this is a really interesting direction for them to actually have all these characters in the same movie and how they're going to play off of each other. Is there anything else about Laura Dern's character specifically that you think that they could tackle in Dominion?
I think there's scope to do some interesting stuff with kind of the paleobotany side of it as well. Because obviously when you think about it, these animals have been let out into mainland USA. So they're kind of all flocking from California. Obviously we know there was the Russian mobster who wanted one, or two carnivores even. So there's gonna kind of be all these animals in ecosystems that aren't their own. So they're gonna be eating plants and foraging for food that isn't necessarily what their diet would have been. So it would be interesting if they find some kind of way to factor that in. Obviously in Jurassic Park we've got the West Indian lilac berries, but I almost wonder if maybe there'll be kind of a scene or something where her paleobotany skills let her track down a dinosaur that's ill in the wild or something like that as a kind of callback to that sequence. I just feel like obviously everyone else, and especially Owen and also Claire, because she had to know it for her job, are very, very knowledgeable of the creatures. But Ellie is the only person who's actually knowledgeable of the environment, so I feel like that could factor in to some extent.
Yeah, they could actually do a lot with that. I have not thought about that until you just brought it up. I'm not so sure exactly if... Well, we don't know enough, really. They could focus on, not necessarily just how the dinosaurs are affecting our ecosystems, but how our ecosystems are affecting the dinosaurs. So that's a very... it's a very twisty way to look at it, that's for sure.
It is. I think it shows how many options there are, because there's so many different ways that this story could go, really.
Well, yeah, there's literally all the ways. They've jammed, Biosyn, Dodson, the original cast, Owen, Claire, and Maisie, as well as the idea of dinosaurs all over the place and in the snow. So, this is the most original, they've never done anything like this before. It's very exciting for me. But I also want to talk to you briefly about how this film has been affected by the virus. I am a little worried that they're going to try to slam 10 pounds into a 5-pound bag, if you know what I mean.
Yeah.
Because they lost a lot of time during the actual initial shoot due to lockdown. So they started everything back up and they've been going 110 miles an hour, but they're still technically 4 or 5 months behind and they never changed the release date. So what are your thoughts on that?
Okay, so there's this group chat I'm in on Twitter, and I'm not particularly popular for this because I'm quite cynical about the whole thing. So obviously I'm a big Jurassic fan and I want Jurassic World Dominion. I want the chance to experience this film. I'm excited for it, as I know everyone else is, but I don't want it to be rushed. And don't get me wrong, I have every confidence that Colin and the creative team wouldn't be pushing it so much if they didn't feel as though they could make a good film. But I do just worry that that 2021 release date is a lot closer than a lot of people realise. And there are a lot of characters in this film. And obviously the fact that only second unit are now shooting in Malta, as I think it was Deadline reported fairly recently, means that there may be an extended need for studio shoots or for green screen work. So I just kind of feel like when I think about that, it kind of it worries me that this isn't the film that they would have wanted to make. And I know that in that regard, what they're doing right now will be able to make up for that. But it's just, it's kind of that difficult realization of, because they have decided to go ahead with this despite everything with coronavirus currently, it means that this may not necessarily be what they envisioned it to be, if that makes sense.
Yeah, I completely 110% agree with you. That's the main thing that has been in the back of my mind. And I know that they're not changing the script, or at least Colin Trevorrow says that they're not, but like, I know that Colin has gone in making this movie. This is a very important movie for the franchise, but it's also, This has never been done before. And couple that on top with the fact that all of these complications through lockdowns and like postponements of filming, and they've never pushed the release date back, I am worried that they would have to compromise some ideas due to the situation. Like, it really, it's not even necessarily their fault. It's whoever's call it was to not push the movie back's fault, I guess. But like, it's like they went out to make a movie, and if this movie isn't as good as it could have been, it's like, wow, bad timing and bad decision making on like, you get where I'm coming from, right?
Yeah, exactly. I think the issue is that obviously they want the good PR for being the first film back into production, and that's understandable, and the measures they've put in place at Pinewood especially are actually really, really robust. So everyone who's working on the film is safe and has got everything they need to basically be able to do their job. But the issue is, even then, it's still an environment where you're not operating in the traditional norm. You're social distancing, you're wearing masks, you're doing a lot of things that kind of
compromise what was the original idea.
Yeah, exactly. They limit the traditional functionality. And I think the thing that worries me the most isn't necessarily the film being rushed or anything being changed or things like that. It's the damage that this could do to the franchise if it is not the film that we're expecting. Purely because I think we all know what the press can be like, and I could very, very easily see them taking this, if it's not a good film, and saying, oh, well, this was a rushed production during coronavirus or something like that. And that would be the kind of PR that I really don't want this franchise to get. So it really feels like this is a gamble, and I really hope that it comes out on top. And as long as everyone continues to be comfortable shooting it and feels happy with what they're working on, then I'm sure it will be. But it's just strange to me that it's a gamble that they were willing to take in the first place.
Well, this is the whole thing. We as fans, I mean, we'll speak out when something rubs us the wrong way or when we love something. And I think one important thing right now is just to say that, as far as me and you go, we are massive fans of Chris Pratt, Bryce Dallas Howard, Sam Neill, Laura Dern, Jeff Goldblum, Colin Trevorrow, Isabella Sermon, everyone working on this movie. I'm like, I've mentioned on Instagram before how much I like Colin Trevorrow. My favorite movie he's done is Book of Henry, and that movie got slagged, and I don't care. I think that's an original great movie. I want the best for all of them. I'm rooting for them, and I hope that everything comes off as perfect as possible. I don't want to see them put in any crazy situations, you know?
No.
That's the whole thing.
Yeah, no, I agree with you fully. I'm of the attitude of, I would have been happy to wait a few months if it meant that they could have filmed post-COVID. And I know that that's a weird sentence to say, because right now we have no idea when the hell this thing's actually going to be under control. But I feel like it seems logical.
Bringing it back around, this whole idea of Laura Dern and Sam Neill and Jeff Goldblum being huddled together in this tight situation, like, this sounds exciting. And I know that they're all working around the clock to bring us like a truly incredible movie. It's all right there. Like, that one scene, we didn't get to see that in the original Jurassic Park. A lot of people don't realize this. Malcolm, he never even interacts with a velociraptor. So
he gets messed up by the T-Rex, and that's it.
That's it. There's that moment in The Lost World where he's in the long grass and they hear the raptors, and he's like, oh no, run as fast as you. And you're like, wait, how do you were never around it. But it's like, this is such a great opportunity to really handle a Jurassic Park sequel that's just running on all cylinders, not even necessarily for fan service for guys like us, but like for the story, this makes sense. And
oh, definitely.
It's exciting.
And, I mean, when you pair it with the fact that that sauna crate got teased, it's just, there's so much possibility. And I like the idea that we're taking things from the past of the franchise, so characters, locations, objects potentially, and then pulling that into the modern day and tying it all together. And I hope that at the end of the day, the production does go according to plan, because being able to tie all of those elements together is going to make a story that will hopefully feel really, really rewarding, not just for casual audiences, but like you say, for people like us who are going to look at it and pick up on all these little details. And I mean, you only need to look at the online conversation around that one crate picture to see how obsessive we can all be. So I think, like, if all of those elements come together, it's going to be a really good experience.
Right. And I think it's just the idea that this little scene description alone, and the idea that Laura Dern is coming back in a role that we haven't seen her in since the first movie, but also everything surrounding the movie, everything going against it, so to speak. Like, this is so exciting. We have the little bit of concerns because we want it to be as good as it can be.
Yeah.
But I think in general, this sounds cool.
Like, oh yeah, definitely. I cannot wait.
Yeah. Anyways, Tom, I think that about wraps it up. So
yeah, cool.
Thanks for joining me. You can actually find Tom. Well, I'll list everything in the description down below. He's on everything, really. But he has his own YouTube channel too. Would you mind if I plug that?
No, that's fine. Thanks, dude. I don't do too much on it. I just kind of stick random bits up on it as and when. But yeah.
All right, well, I'll put it there too. Thanks for watching, guys, and whatever you think about Laura Dern's involvement in the new movie, COVID, or the Jurassic World Dominion scene that Jeff Goldblum talked about in general, we'd love to hear everything you have to say in the comments down below. Now, before I go, I'd like to thank all of my game wardens, as well as all of my engine executives. I'd also like to thank all of my park workers and engine hunters as well. Guys, it seriously means the world to me that you all continue to support what I do, and I never want you to ever forget that. Now, I'd like to thank you all for watching today's video, and hope you all enjoyed the content. If you feel like I deserve it, I'd appreciate the like, and hope that you'll consider subscribing if you're interested in hearing from me again. I'll see you all in the next video, guys, and as always, take it easy.